Good afternoon, Rotarians. To kick off today's meeting, I'd like for Past President Jeff Hildebrand to lead us in the four-way test, prayer, and pledge. Jeff?
Thank you very much, Denver. Please join me in stating the four-way test. Of the things we think, say, or do, is it the truth? Is it fair to all concerned? Will it build goodwill and better friendships? Will it be beneficial to all concerned? Please bow in prayer with me. May those assembled here today enjoy the many offerings of Rotary. May we abide by the rules we have established, those of trust, fellowship, and ethics, and may we place service above self in our daily endeavors. May we test ourselves in our efforts to be sure they are the truth, good for all concerned, a benefit to mankind, and provide peace and understanding. Amen. Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, Jeff, and thanks to our greeters, Marge Bentley, Marisha DiCarlo, Katie Calvert, and Aaron Finzer. Also, thanks to Greg McCarroll for his ongoing support. Last Tuesday, we lost another former Club 99er with the passing of Carl Gregory Mashburn. So if you will, just please join me briefly for a moment of silence. Thank you. Next, I'd like for J.D. Lowry to introduce our guests, and then Molly McNulty to introduce our newest member to Club 99.
Good morning, or good afternoon. We'll start with our visiting Rotarians first. We have Ross Burnett and Chris Dudley from Rotaract. If you might stand. Our guests today are several pages long. Gabrielle Edwards and Devin Hancock with Ross O'Young. Teddy Stewart, a guest of Denver Peacock, and Olivia Wells, also with Denver Peacock. Jacques Patak with Vanessa Russell. Palmer Husman, Denver Peacock. Nathan Kennard with Mandy Richardson. Wynn Rockefeller with Denver Peacock. Lee Kirkpatrick with Chris Bond. Colin McKnight with Amy Daffler Moe. Also with her is Jack Darling, Emma Mitchell, Revelin Lisa Corey, Mary Hodges, with Bill Dillard III, a guest of Frank Lawrence, Morgan Wittman with Patricia Black, Valentine Hokey with Laza, Suzanne Grubmeyer, Molly McNulty, Perry McAdoo with Elizabeth Smith, Christopher Keller with John Stevens, Jenzie Higgs with Kathleen Lawson, Martha Masters also with Kathleen Lawson, Will Rockefeller, Denver Peacock, Mimi San Pedro, Chad Brown, Sam Duncombe with Chris Duncombe, Ben Walters with Ashvin, I'm mispronouncing your name, I apologize. Man, it's tough up here. J.R. Bazell and Ryan Mahoney with Denver Peacock. Olivia Ramsey, also with Denver Peacock. Joe Ramsey with Denver Peacock. Catherine Pryor with Will Trice. Bruce Moore, guest of Susan Altrui. Sarita Sandisham with Hillary Hadigan. Rex Nelson, guest of Denver Peacock. Denver gets the award today. Lieutenant Governor Leslie Rutledge, guest of Susan Altrui. Jerome Strickland Jr. with Molly McNulty. Courtney Ross, guest of Ellen Cockrell. Jimmy Warren, guest of Denver. Wally Nixon, guest of Emily Clay. And then Judge Cindy Thayer, guest of Wendy Wood. Thank you for being here today. This is a good group.
Good afternoon. Today we mark our 30th week of new member introductions. And it's my distinct pleasure to introduce our newest Club 99 member to you all, Matt McClendon. Matt is sponsored by President Denver Peacock, Courtney Little, and Mike Marquez. Matt is the founder of DSG, a Little Rock consultant-based business acquired by Corporate Visions, CBI, in 2022, where he now serves on the board and as an advisor. During his more than 22 years with DSG, he served as a senior partner and CEO of the company and provided client-specific playbooks for strategy, messaging, process, and leadership. Previously, he worked at AT&T as an enterprise marketing director. Matt also serves on the board of directors for Easter Seals, Arkansas. Born and raised in Little Rock, Matt and his wife Suzanne have reared their three children in the capital city. A graduate of Catholic High School for Boys and Texas Christian University, Matt and his family are avid Razorback fans. But they also root for the Baylor Bears, Suzanne's alma mater, the Wake Forest Demon Deacons, where son Max attends, and the TCU Horned Frogs, where daughter Carol Ann attends. All great teams, and Matt, you'll find many fellow fans among Club 99 members. Welcome to Rotary. We're glad you're here.
Thank you, JD and Molly, and congrats, Matt. Welcome to Club 99. Our new member streak continues. 30 straight meetings. It's incredible. Guys, let's keep it going. Next week, please join us for the launch of Every Child Arkansas, an innovative new foster care network for our state. It's going to be amazing. During my State of the Club remarks, I announced my Illuminate the Rock theme and plans for our club to take on a new initiative to light the Veterans Memorial Bridge. What many call the Broadway Bridge, arguably the most beautiful one in Arkansas. As a gift to our community during our tricentennial year, I said I would love for Club 99 to kick off the process of lighting its iconic arches. This project is much more than just lights on a bridge. If done right, it will serve as a catalyst for our tourism offerings. The lit arches will be the money shot for future tourism content promoting our region, and economic development investments with views of the bridge. Imagine new mixed-use spaces with rooftop bars and restaurants, weekly light shows synced up to your favorite tunes, new programs to highlight the work of our area nonprofits, youth engagement through STEM initiatives and coding opportunities, bridging our cultural divides and creating new opportunities to bring us together as one region by paying tribute to our veterans community with a renewed focus on one of our region's greatest assets, the Arkansas River. It's all there, well within our reach. We've seen this done already in other communities. Officials with Milwaukee's Light the Home Bridge have launched a successful youth coding initiative and intern challenge. We can and should do that here in Central Arkansas, where we already have a bridge lighting culture and a growing tech sector. So today, I'm excited to unveil our illuminatetherock.com website and a sample video simulation of how it could look to the tunes of U2's Beautiful Day. Check out the site now. Hey guys, isn't that cool? It's my hope that a lit Veterans Memorial Bridge will be a permanent reminder of our community service and the light we're already shining on our community. We have nearly 10% of our needed pledges in place already, but we need to secure a foundational gift to help us kickstart our efforts. So please let me know if you're interested. Love to talk to you. I know this can be done, and it will be done, because working together, we will illuminate the rock. Thank you. All right, now, back to the stories that you love. During our La Petite Rose tricentennial, I will spend my year as president telling unique stories about our region's past 300 years. With today's program about emerging third-generation Arkansas leaders, I'd like to tell the story of a third-generation American leader like today's panelists who chose to make Arkansas his home. Arkansas Governor Win Rockefeller was the grandson of Standard Oil Company founder John D. Rockefeller and born in New York City, the fifth of six children by Abby Aldrich and John D. Rockefeller, Jr. Despite the luxuries offered to him as a young man, he repeatedly chose to carve his own unique path, not the corporate urban life laid out for him. He wanted the freedom of working in the oil fields, of serving in the Army, and ultimately of choosing to make his home in a poor rural state. After serving in the Pacific during World War II, where he rose to lieutenant colonel, he visited his wartime friend Frank Newell of Little Rock, and shortly after this eye-opening visit, he purchased most of Petitjean Mountain and made Arkansas his new home. He was soon tasked with helping transform the state's economy through his service on IADC and was responsible for bringing over 600 industrial plants and 90,000 new jobs to the state. He would serve 4 years as governor, the state's first Republican governor since Reconstruction, and as Rex Nelson, who's here today, likes to say, WR brought numerous reforms to our state, including paving the way for 50-plus years of moderate, pragmatic leadership at the state capitol. Governors Bumpers, Pryor, Clinton, White, Tucker, Huckabee, Beebe, Hutchison, and now Sanders would follow. He had a special connection to black Arkansans, showing respect and attention to these new voters who rewarded him with 80% of the vote. He cracked down on illegal gaming in Hot Springs, implemented the state's first minimum wage law, and much to Eliza's family's delight, he signed the Freedom of Information Act and brought on significant prison reform. He was also the only Southern governor, get this, to hold a public ceremony mourning the passing of Martin Luther King Jr. His philanthropy was well regarded as well. His second wife, Jeanette, and he led efforts to establish what is now the Arkansas Museum of Fine Arts, along with many other prominent families along the years. His son, the late Winthrop Paul Rockefeller, was lieutenant governor until his untimely passing in 2006. He had declared his candidacy for governor that year, but dropped out before the primaries. And later, the newly elected governor-elect Mike Beebe said, and I quote, "Had he lived, we all know I would not have been here, but rather, we would have been congratulating a good friend and a great Arkansan as the next governor, Win Paul Rockefeller." Two of his sons, Win and Will, also third generation Arkansans, are here today. So welcome to you both. Tomorrow, coincidentally, marks the 50th anniversary of Governor Rockefeller's death in 1973. And although Rockefeller died at the young age of 60, he left behind a rich and vital legacy. His considerable wealth was divided into the Winthrop Rockefeller Foundation and a charitable trust that helped establish Winrock International and Winrock Institute on Petit Jean Mountain. All of them still making lasting contributions to the quality of life in his adopted home state. And that's our Illuminating the Rock story for this week. And now I'd like for Ross Al Young to introduce today's distinguished panel. Ross?
Good afternoon. I'm happy for you all to join us for our panel discussion of the next generation of Arkansas family leaders with Anne-Marie Dillard-Jazak, John Stevens, and Stuart Walton with our moderator, Eliza Hussman Gaines. As many of you know, the names Dillard, Stevens, and Walton with others have been synonymous with setting the business, philanthropic, and quality of life standards in Arkansas for decades. Working in the philanthropic arena in the Arkansas Museum of Fine Arts, I'm seeing firsthand the difference these families are making in Arkansas every day when I go to work. It's exciting to see the next generations of family leaders stepping up who will set the course of the state for decades to come. Anne-Marie is the Vice President of E-Commerce and Digital Marketing for Dillard's and a third-generation Arkansas-based retail executive. She has over two decades of retail experience with a breadth of expertise ranging from visual merchandising, buying, trend direction, marketing, and e-commerce. John is a senior vice president of member of the Mergers and Acquisitions Group for Stevens Inc. He previously was an associate director of Stevens Europe. Prior to serving in Europe, he was part of the Stevens Inc. consumer-based team in New York, where he provided corporate finance and advisory services to clients in the food and agribusiness, consumer products, and retail and apparel sectors. Stuart is the co-founder of Runway Group, a holding company that invests in real estate, hospitality, and other businesses in Northwest Arkansas. He is the founder and chairman of Game Composites, LLC, a company that designs and builds small composite aircraft. And moderating our discussion today is Eliza Hussman Gaines. Eliza is the fourth generation of her family in the newspaper industry. She is the publisher of 11 daily and 8 weekly newspapers in Arkansas, Missouri, and Tennessee. Each hold a plethora of board and committee positions where their philanthropic efforts help support and advance this city, state, and nation. Rotarians and guests, it is my honor to welcome Anne-Marie Dillard-Jazak, John Stevens, Stuart Walton and Eliza Hussman Gaines to the stage.
Is this on?
This one's on.
Hello? Can you hear? Okay, great. All right, well, let's jump right in. We'll start with Stuart. Stuart, you could live anywhere in the world. What is it about Arkansas that pulled you back home?
Well, there's obvious answers like being close to family, and those are probably the most important ones. Can you all hear me? I can't.
Here.
Testing. Oh, I think they got me. Hello? Well, there we go. So there's obvious answers, I think, like being close to family. My parents still live in Bentonville. My brother does. And I think those are the most important reasons for wanting to be back in Arkansas and live back here. But if I was going to think about kind of professionally why I wanted to move back and what it means to me, I'd sort of boil it down into two words. One is opportunity and the other is impact. And on the opportunity front, and I think a lot of folks in this room can kind of relate, but Arkansas, when I was growing up, was either 49th or 50th in a whole lot of things that you didn't want to be 49th or 50th in. And I think everybody's probably also heard the saying of, like, thank God for Mississippi, because when we were 49th, they were usually 50th. And over the last, like, 15 years, I think a lot of folks in this room can also resonate with the idea that things have gotten better. And instead of 49th, we might be like 41st or 46th or 44th. And these are issues like, the health of the population, lifespan, educational attainment, performance of our public schools across the state. So, like, things you want to be good at, right? And things you want to do well at. And so, as you start to see the state improving on some of these metrics, I think what's starting to become clear to me and what became clear to me is the opportunity to really come back and kind of put the pedal down and try to really move the needle on some of these things. Because I'd say as Arkansans, we shouldn't be satisfied with those numbers. In fact, we should be maybe even borderline upset with them. And we should all kind of treat them as a fire to be lit underneath our tail to get after it and improve our situation and improve our standing relative to a lot of other states. And it's not like competition in terms of we're gonna beat them, but it's like trying to become the best version of yourself. And I have a hard time thinking or accepting that the best version of Arkansas on a lot of these really important metrics is 41 or 46 or 48 out of 50 when we wanna be top 10 or top 20. And so that's kind of the opportunity that I see for the state is to sort of shake off this sort of situation and really set some goals around where we need to go and then figure out how to get there. And so at Runway Group, we're trying to do that. And the sort of second word, impact, which is the how to get there piece, that kind of started with work with my brother, and it was a trail that was blazed long before us by my aunt, my parents, my grandparents, and they really showed the importance of giving back to your community. And if you look across the country, the communities that outperform and the communities that are on the move and that are creating really vibrant places are inevitably communities where people are reinvesting their resources within that community. And it's that one single distinction, I'd argue, that sets communities apart that are thriving versus the communities that are not thriving or stagnating or even in some cases going backwards. And so as we kind of saw this example set by my parents and those that came before them and saw the impact and the power of investing in your community, those are the two things that really brought me back.
John and then Anne Marie. Beyond the obvious of where your respective companies are located, what drew you back to Arkansas?
Testing. Can I?
I'm just
going to put these out. We came home after 3 years in London. We got married in 17 and moved over there and had a great 3 years over there and learned that my wife, Mary Olive, was expecting in March of 2020, and that's what brought us home, and we always figured that's what would bring us home. You know, we loved our experiences in London and New York prior to that, but we also knew that when we started the next chapter, we wanted to be somewhere that we were comfortable with, familiar with, had a lot of support, and that's what we did, and we're really happy about it. It wasn't professionally motivated, but I will say being back here, you know, being a couple floors below my dad or a couple floors above my brother has been a lot of fun and very rewarding, and I feel kind of more productive than I did over in London, but that's kind of besides the point.
Well, I grew up here, love Little Rock, and I lived in California for 13 years. I went to USC and stayed after graduation, and I met my husband there. And I loved it while I was young, and we got older, and 6 months before we moved back to Arkansas, if you asked me if I was going to move back to Arkansas, I would have said no. But then we got married, and my husband came back to Little Rock with me, and he retired from playing professional soccer and said, I said, we can either go to Little Rock or Texas, and he had no doubt he wanted to go to Little Rock. And I thought we'd be in Dallas, so I was like, okay, this is interesting. We're going to go to Little Rock because that's where I can have a bigger career with Dillard's, and he went into coaching. And I'm so glad that he made us do that he made that decision for our family, because I love Little Rock, and he saw in Little Rock, as somebody who's lived in five different countries and speaks five different languages and was moving from LA, he saw the value in Little Rock that I have come to realize what a tremendous blessing it is to live here. You know, I really became disenchanted with Los Angeles at the end. It was a big anonymous city where there wasn't a community. We didn't even know our neighbors, and we lived in an apartment building. So that's kind of crazy to not even know your neighbors in an apartment building. So, you know, wanting to kind of come back to a place that has more values, is a more value-oriented place, that there's community, there's support for one another. Those are the things that in the end brought us back, and I couldn't be happier that he made that decision, which I think speaks a lot to what this state offers, that somebody who's lived so many different places chose to come here over Dallas. So.
There seems to be an active effort, like this panel today, to build relationships between these third and fourth generation family leaders. Why are those relationships important, and how can you collectively push for good? Stuart, let's start with you.
Well, I hadn't actually met Anne-Marie and John until I did move back. It was maybe just a couple of years ago. But it's been wonderful to get more connected and develop friendships with folks down here in Little Rock and even across the state. And I'm sure they'll serve us well in each of our own personal endeavors. But, you know, I don't know if I'd be coming down for the Museum of Fine Arts opening in April if it wasn't for these two and the connections that we've been able to build over the last couple of years. And so I think that whether it's them coming up to Northwest Arkansas on occasion or us coming down here and enjoying all the state has to offer, it really helps round out your perspective and kind of click up a level from your sort of region or local community into the state community and see all the things that we have in common, all the things we need to work on together. And I just really enjoy coming down, and it's been great to meet these guys.
Anything to add?
You know, I think it's interesting because you talked about our parents' generation. And I was at the Arkansas Business Hall of Fame induction on Friday night. And something that I heard them say repeatedly was about all these connections in this community in Arkansas and how none of these companies made it on their own. And there was, Stevens was referenced as helping another company to grow. And we all know Stevens has had an impact on Walmart. And Sam Walton wrote the foreword and a biography written about my grandfather. And it just really illustrated to me when you brought up the generations, like there's 100 years of this community that's helped all of these other companies to get to where they are. And I think that's something that's really special about Arkansas. And it kind of parlayed out of why we moved back was for this community, but it extends beyond that personal, you know, reach. And it really goes into the businesses and why they're successful and how we've had these multiple 100-year-old companies that sell billions of dollars a year. It's pretty incredible. and to see how those relationships have transcended generations. I thought that was really special and something that I don't think every state has. So I'm excited that we're all friends and that we have other friendships, and I hope that there's a ton of new companies that are started that maybe some of these older companies can help to see that same growth. And there'll be, you know, three more generations from now, there'll be three different people up here that started, but maybe that we or our companies had an impact on. So I think that like generational element is really important in building these communities that support one another and can allow companies to have the kind of success that we've been fortunate enough to be part of.
Yeah, I don't have too much to add. I would like to give Anne-Marie credit because I think Anne-Marie and Stuart met on a COVID economic council, and then she connected all of us together and I think had some foresight in doing that. So thank you for doing that.
Are there some collective goals that have developed among these next generation leaders that will move the state forward, making it an even better place to live and work? John?
So we haven't collectively sat down and, you know, decided on anything together. I think when you look at it, I can kind of pretty easily partition it into maybe four buckets, looking at it sort of from a concentric circle point of view. And one that's obvious is arts. So, you know, Crystal Bridges is transformational. AMFA will be, I think, transformational and has been for multiple generations now in Little Rock. So that's one area. The other would be, or another would be, tourism and kind of, you know, capitalizing on the natural beauty of the state, all of the outdoor activities you can participate in. All credit to Stuart and Tom on the biking and that, but there's other things, hunting, hiking, camping, rafting, all that stuff I think is an initiative that we all care about, that the new administration cares about, and I'm excited about that. Healthcare in Central Arkansas is and always has been a really big deal, and we got to make sure that we continue to support those institutions and allow them to grow and you know, prosper and flourish. And healthcare in Northwest Arkansas with the population growth up there is a big deal and will become a bigger deal. And you know, those things don't need to be competitive. They need, you know, I think you could do that in a way where the rising tide lifts all boats. And that will be a big theme, I would imagine, for our state and for philanthropic endeavors within the state forever, for good reason. And then education, I saved that for last, just because there is a good anecdote in my life right now that kind of shows how all these relationships can come together. But I went to University of Pennsylvania. A fraternity brother of mine who's from Washington, D.C., is named Michael McGregor. After school, he became a charter school teacher, became a leader within his charter school and became an administrator, then became the CFO of a charter school network. And then we ended up overlapping again at Columbia Business School. And so we stayed great friends kind of for the last 15 or 20 years. He was tapped by Jim and Alice's Equitable Facilities Fund to help them run that, which is a really hugely generous fund that enables charter schools to access cheaper funds for facilities so that they can then, you know, focus more of their dollars on the students and the education. And so because of, I think, a burgeoning or start, you know, new relationship with the Waltons, I got to meet both of his parents when I was up there not too long ago, which was great. You know, have a friend who I went to school with, who I trust and know, who is passionate about what he has done and is doing. And so I've, and then locally, there's, you know, families like the Hussmans, the Dillards, the Rockefellers, many more have been passionate about charter schools for decades. And so my wife and I are gonna give a little bit to that effort, and we're helping to lead an effort to hopefully raise some money. And I think the state will be supportive to get an Arkansas-focused facility or fund just for the charter school build out in this state alone. So that's an exciting effort that I think is a good example of.
That is a beautiful answer.
Well, no, thanks.
Perfect.
Yeah, so.
That's, I did the thinking on that.
Yeah. Anne-Marie, anything to add?
I think you really thought that one through. But I would credit Tom and Stuart for a lot of what they did when they came back with the Heartland Summit. I'm not sure how many of you are familiar with that, and if you're not, you should look it up because it's really incredible. And it's not just focused on Arkansas, but we are definitely in the core of the Heartland. And I think y'all have really started a lot of those conversations in this part of the country and gotten a lot of us thinking. I know my cousin Bill and I have been involved a little bit there, and we just appreciate the momentum that you guys have started, and I hope that everyone can jump on board and carry it to a much higher height than you've already gotten it there. But I think that in terms of, like, collaborating together, you know, you and your brother deserve a lot of credit for initiating that momentum.
I don't know that we deserve a ton of credit, but what I would say is I think that what you see here is an opportunity for Arkansas across the state to really lead the conversation about economic development, educational improvement and attainment, bringing arts into the heartland and bringing arts into your community and the important role that that plays. And, you know, I think that if you sort of think about the country and the economic growth and where that's been over the last 20, 30 years, mostly focused on the coast with a couple of kind of outliers. Texas is sort of coastal, if it depends on who you ask. But Arkansas really has a chance to lead the heartland and show a way forward to prosper in the 21st century that other states around us, either adjacent or further afield, can follow. And to the extent that we can grab that mantle and run with it and not only talk about what's going to work but show what works, I think we have just tremendous opportunity to be a leader in that respect.
Stuart, you helped chair the pandemic task force. How have you benefited from connecting with other leaders across the state and gained an appreciation for economic and quality of life development throughout the entire state?
I'll be quick here. To me, the best outcome of that was actually meeting all the various people that I got to get to know, whether it was in the governor's office, folks like Anne Marie, who then introduced me to John, Mayor Scott here, just a tremendous number of people, Stacy Hurst. And those relationships not only were fun and fulfilling, but they were also important and have grown and blossomed into other opportunities and interests and alignment. And I think one of the biggest risks to Arkansas is everybody kind of gets their blinders on and starts focusing on their business or their hometown or their, you know, county, and forgets that, hey, we're all in this together, and it's not a fixed pie. This pie is going to grow. It's going to grow a lot, and we got to help it grow. And the only way we're going to do that is by growing it, like, homogeneously and together. Not one little slice grows big and eats up another slice and all that. Like, we really have to work together. And being able to connect with people from around the state was, to me, the best outcome that I could have possibly hoped for participating in that. And it really helped us elevate our view to a statewide view and the importance of that.
Anne Marie, you've been the focal point of ads for the Arkansas Economic Development Commission. How did that campaign come together, and why was it important for you to participate?
Well, it came together from being on the Economic Recovery Task Force, and I formed a relationship with Mike Preston and Governor Hutchison, who, you know, I really admired the way that I think he handled COVID and, you know, how traumatic that was, both personally and from a corporate perspective. I think he was very thoughtful and pragmatic, and I was very thankful for his leadership, so we formed a relationship. And then, in that relationship, I think he realized how passionate I was about this state, because I feel like often I leave the state to go to things, and I end up being a cheerleader or a marketer, you know, de facto, just because people will come up to me. I was just at a conference, for instance, in Austin, Texas, 2 weeks ago, and they said, oh, are you from New York, or are you from, you live in Dallas, right? And I'm like, no, I'm from Arkansas. And people would say, oh, Arkansas, what's that like? And then I go into like a 10, 15 minute, you know, platform of why this is the greatest state and how they're missing out by not coming and seeing this amazing state and how beautiful it is and how many amazing people there are. And they always say, are there other people like you there? And I said, there are so many people like me here that I can't meet them all. I desperately want to spend time with them, but there's not enough hours in the day. If I met one every day, there's only 365 days in the year. I couldn't meet them all. There's so many amazing people here, and that's something that I just really want to spread the word about, because it's very sad to me, when I lived in California, for Arkansas to be called a flyover state, which meant no one went here, no one stopped. The plane flew from LA to New York and Florida, and it didn't go to the flyover states. And that's what we're called, is the flyover states. And I just think that it's so tragic for them to live a lifetime in the United States of America and not see this great state and the great things that we have to offer. So I end up being an unofficial marketer, and I think that they liked that take, so they asked me to be part of the campaign. But I do, I genuinely feel that way. It's an incredible state with incredible people. It's beautiful. We have the most amazing businesses that have been born here and have built our communities for generations now. It's a pretty special place that I think the whole country should give more credit than we get.
We need 100 more, 1,000 more, just
everyone,
like Anne-Marie.
Everyone needs to market this.
Stuart, you and Tom have continued to make important investments in outdoor recreation throughout Arkansas, including in Little Rock through your trail investments at Pinnacle Mountain and River Mountain. The first gentleman, Brian Sanders, recently appointed him to chair the National State Advisory Council, a new council to promote outdoor recreation and tourism. Why is it important to have a statewide lens when it comes to these economic development and tourism efforts?
Well, I mean, I think it's a massive opportunity for the state. And let me just give you a couple pieces of context. If you drop a pin on Bentonville and draw a 500-mile radius around it, which is roughly about a one-day drive, more or less an eight-hour drive, you've got 66 million people that live within that circle. If you take that same approach and drop that pin on Breckenridge, Colorado, draw that circle, you've got 16 million people. And you think of the number of people that would be interested in coming to Bentonville, or not even just Bentonville. You could do the same exercise with Little Rock, and it wouldn't yield a big delta, I don't think. But you think about the population that could drive to our state within a day, and you think about what's going to attract them here. And then you combine that with the idea that the Ozarks and the Ouachitas are the most isolated mountain ranges in the United States. If you go northeast, south, or west from any of those mountain ranges, you've got a lot of flat land before you hit another hill. And so you've got an outdoor recreational opportunity of a lifetime, I think, right here in the state that can be leveraged to drive our economy. And there's 66 million people that are within a day's drive that would love to come here and recreate. Why don't they do that yet? I think it comes down to one word: access. The hills, the valleys, the rivers, the lakes, they've always been here. Lakes maybe not quite as long as the rest of them, but more or less they've always been here for my lifetime anyway. But we haven't always had good access to them. And that's one of the kind of learnings we've had up in Bentonville, is the valleys and the springs and the creeks and the rivers and all the terrain that makes the mountain biking up there possible and makes the mountain biking here possible has been there since long before any of us have been around, yet we didn't have the infrastructure in place to let people enjoy it. And as we started building these trails, creating this access, it brings the woods alive. It makes them accessible. It makes them approachable. And the closer you can do that to where people live, the more powerful and more valuable those access points and that infrastructure becomes. And you can take that same approach and apply it to rivers, lakes, rock climbing areas, forests, hiking, biking, you know, horseback riding, on and on and on down the list. And so to me, given that kind of circumstance, we're just scratching the surface on where we could be with this outdoor recreation economy. And I couldn't be more appreciative of the governor and the first gentleman's work in this. I think they're really going to lead us to a great place.
John, the Stevens family has been at the center of promoting the public-private partnership for the Arkansas Museum of Fine Arts. Why has that project been so important to your family, and what can its redevelopment mean for downtown Little Rock and the state?
Well, I'd start probably by saying, in this case, we're well aware that we're building kind of on the shoulders of giants, if you will. We're building on a foundation that's kind of been being built for, I don't know how many years, 70 or 80 at this point. Rockefeller's being a big part of it, the city been a big part of the support as well. And it hasn't been my personal focus. It's been my parents, and my wife is now on the AMFA board. But I do remember going there. I think the key to remember both about AMFA and Crystal Bridges is that they're free to the public. And so I remember going there, and I was fortunate enough to be able to go around the world and see things as a person growing up. But even still, you go into a place like that, and it's really inspiring, and it can really, one visit could, I think, alter the path of a young person's life just through what they see and what they're exposed to, and then how it opens their mind, and that can really change how you carry yourself going forward. And so I think, that's why it's important to me personally. I think it's a beautiful building. I think the collection is going to be world class, and I'm really proud of the work that my parents have done to get it there. But again, it's a huge community effort, and so we want to make sure to say that. So,
Stuart, it's no secret that Crystal Bridges has been transformational for Northwest Arkansas. How can Little Rock be sure to maximize having AMFA here?
Oh, I don't know if I have a good response to that one. It was a, I think about the way Crystal Bridges impacted Bentonville, and maybe there's some threads you could draw. But what Crystal Bridges does so beautifully is they don't try to answer the questions; they just try to ask the questions, and it makes it an incredibly welcoming institution. They don't have an agenda. They don't have a point of view that they're trying to push on people or trying to, it's not about arguing and being right. It's about simply presenting what is and asking good questions and fostering the debate. And its role in our community has been, I think, elevated because of the approach that they took with that. And so we've had conversations brought to the community that not everybody is welcomed, but the institution's been a forum for hosting those conversations, and they've been rich conversations and positive conversations. And so I think that to the extent that AMFA could kind of take on a little bit of that same mentality, it'd probably be healthy.
John, you and your wife, Mary Olive, are investing in George's, the Heights Italian restaurant. It's gained quite a bit of buzz lately. Can you update us on its progress and when we might see an opening?
No, I can't, because I'm under strict instructions by my business partner that I can't give any specific dates or openings. But I just say warmer weather, summer 2023. So
soonish,
yeah. So within a couple months.
Great. Yeah. Are there any other local restaurants or quality of life amenities that you have in the works?
There's another lot just down the street in the Heights on Fillmore and Cavanaugh, and I don't know who bought that, but maybe I do, but I don't know what we're going to do with it. But we did have a great time in the UK. I loved pub culture. I didn't love pub food, and I'll just leave it at that, but something maybe along those lines one day on that property. And then I would also point out that we actually have some things going on up in Northwest Arkansas as well. So, we're not going to let that exciting market go untapped either. So, yeah.
Stuart, how helpful have your investments in local dining, hospitality, and even bike trails been in transforming Northwest Arkansas as an attractive tourist destination and a great place to relocate?
Oh, I think they're critical. I mean, we started Rope Swing Group, which is the hospitality company, because we couldn't get people to come to a restaurant in the buildings that we owned, and it's sort of taken on this life of its own. And I'd say, I'll be a little hard on us here, but I'd say if you sort of graded hospitality companies 1 to 10, 10 being 11 Madison Park or Danny Meyer, and 1 being somewhere you've never heard of, We're like a 4 or 5. And our goal is to keep raising the bar, right? And the hospitality business, as I'm sure a lot of you in the room know, it's hard. It is stinking tough to run as a business and to run well and at a high level and to really kind of build a thriving enterprise. And we're getting better, but the fact that we're there and trying has been the most important thing in the first place. And people do come to Bentonville and they are surprised by the culinary offerings that we have. And we keep adding to that. And the beautiful thing about it actually has been that I think we've inspired other people to come and do the same thing. And you know, I would argue that nobody can do it all. Doesn't matter who you are, where you're from, or what city you're in. But to the extent that you can show a little bit of a way and bring people in who are as good as you or hopefully even better than you, and then you respond to that, and you get this kind of ever-improving dynamic going, then you can really get to a place that's very exciting. And so we're kind of over the hill a little bit on the hospitality. Like I think we've crested the hardest parts, and we're kind of resetting the bar and resetting our expectations about where we're going to be. But there's certain things that every community needs to be an attractive place to visit and an attractive place to live, and a good place to eat out, you know, is right up there, the kind of the most important things that you need.
Any lesson learned from your experiences that you would share with others who see opportunities in that space? Any tips?
Chefs are difficult people to work with. but artists in their own right.
Annemarie, it feels like the state is at a turning point. Arkansas has the youngest governor in the country, and prominent state businesses are turning to younger leadership. How can we be sure the state benefits from this youth movement?
Well, I think you're right. We do see a lot of changing of the guard. We do have a young new governor who herself, you know, is a, her father was governor before. But I think that something that we've always done really well, and something else I heard a lot during that Arkansas Business Hall of Fame, was these 100-year-old companies. There's value in that experience and in that pragmatism that got these companies to where they are. So I think really the key for us is we have to partner with the generation before us to take with us their pragmatism, their thoughtfulness, their ingenuity, their work ethic, their determination, and then layer on top of that our new ideas and our enthusiasm. And I think if we can do that and we can appreciate what our previous generation has to offer and appreciate what our generation can bring to the table, and then even appreciate what a generation beneath us, which is already born, can bring to the table, I think that could be a really incredible combination and something that would really set us apart and really be the key to our success. So, you know, I think that really could define how our state moves forward, you know, embracing that past and then layering on top of it the ingenuity and thoughtfulness and excitement that our generation brings to the table. So
it looks like we will have time for some audience questions, so please start getting those ready if you have them. Before that, is there anything that you all would like to add?
Well, I want to thank you, Eliza, because thank you for bringing us all together in Denver. Thank you. I know it wasn't easy to get everyone's schedules aligned because it's a busy group up here. But I want to thank you for these wonderful, thoughtful questions and for everything your family for generations, not four generations, have done for our community. The Democrat Gazette is an incredible paper, and you guys are wonderful journalists, and we are fortunate to have you. We're fortunate to have your publications and the information that you are able to provide all of us with on a daily basis. Not every state has that. Dillard's operates in a lot of states, and we can say that what we have here is really unique. So thank you very much.
Thank you for saying that. And thank all three of you for being great supporters of our newspaper and local media. It's very much appreciated. And thank you, Denver and Chris Bond, who also helped with the questions very much. Any questions from the audience? There has to be at least one over here in the green.
Awesome. And so, I don't know if you talked about a lot of economic development in our state and given that new administration and their usher, you think that's obviously their priority areas of administration.
how can business leaders be advocates for state agencies?
Well, I will say I follow legislation as much as Democrat Gazette covers it, but I am not an expert in what's going on in the legislative process. I'm a retailer. If you want to ask me about retail, I'll tell you all about the next fashion trends coming up this spring, so I don't want to speak too much.
I have a slight, like, tangential response maybe that might show a little bit of my political colors, which I'm not trying to do. But, you know, I think there's probably a healthy debate to be had about where economic investment and the drivers of economic growth come from, and are they better off coming through a government body, or should they be more philanthropically focused, or should they be simply the private sector? And so that, to me, seems like a pretty good debate to have. But I also think that, one point of view that we tend to have in Runway Group is that, you know, politics can put up a lot of barriers and a lot of roadblocks and create a lot of problems. Now, it can do a lot of good, and there's no substitute for good governance either. So I'm not sort of saying blow up the government. But I think what is interesting and encouraging that I'm hearing out of the Capitol is a lot of focus on trying to reduce some of those barriers that get sometimes inadvertently created for businesses to do more, and for individuals to do more, and for philanthropies to do more. And so I think that's kind of a good orientation, like net-net. But where the dollars should come from, or how they should be channeled back into the economy, and what's going to create the most growth, I think is a pretty good question to debate. And so hopefully they're having good debates up there on those topics.
Another question?
So you're all from multi-generational families and this next generation. Do you have a said or unsaid mantra that's gone through your family that's driven y'all for these years that you kind of grew up with and has brought you to where you are today?
The question is there a multi-generational mantra that has gone through your generations to kind of push you forward? It's a good question.
I'm not trying to talk too much. I feel like I am. There's sort of two that jump into my mind. One is what my grandmother had above her desk, which is, it's not what you gather in life, but what you scatter that tells the kind of life you live. And that is just kind of anchoring in our family's work together, and I think that embodies this idea of giving back to your community. And the other one would be access. And whether you're talking about Walmart or Crystal Bridges or the bike trails or any number of other things that we're trying to do, access and providing access to good quality goods at a great price, to world-class art for free, to our nature and natural assets that we have as a state to recreate in, that word really drives a lot of our work across a number of different for-profit philanthropic kinds of ideas.
We don't have anything that's officially written down, but my grandfather had a lot of incredible quotes, and I think the three things I would take away, and just aggregating quickly in my head, his quotes were, you know, determination, and that's always been something that's been really put in a lot of the messages that our parents and our grandparents' generation have given us. Work ethic, so a strong work ethic. I think our family is committed to working very hard and continuing that work of our past generations. And integrity. My grandfather spoke a lot about integrity and how good business mandates having high integrity. So I think those are kind of the three themes that have been passed down for us.
Ours are kind of the same, really. In the finance business, you know, balance sheets matter. So we have a very simple rule, which is, you know, don't over leverage and don't take bets that could bring down the business. I.e., you can always wake up the next morning and the business will be there and you'll have another chance to do it. But what goes in conjunction with that is integrity. So always go to sleep with your integrity intact. And it's a very reputational driven business. So that's important, but also it's, you know, how we want to kind of do business. And I'm proud of the fact that I think our fortune kind of comes from investments in companies and that are largely uncontroversial. And so I'm kind of rambling at this point, but keep your integrity and you know, mind the balance sheet. Is kind of that's it.
I think we have time for one more question.
I think that's a good one to end on. I appreciate all of you being here. Ross for the intro, John, Anne Marie, Stuart, and Eliza. Very grateful for all of you agreeing to do this and actually finding the time to make it work. That's incredible. You guys do have busy lives, and we're grateful that you have chosen to invest in Arkansas and in Little Rock, and we appreciate all of you for making an effort to be here. This year, we have speakers' gifts that we're giving to each of our speakers. It's a token of, these are books by Little Rock Connected authors, and we're going to give them a collection of these books to our area Little Rock School District resource centers and libraries, and they will all have everybody that spoke to Rotary Club this year, and your names will be among them, so we are grateful for you being a part of it. Please stick around. Let's do a photo, so don't jump off just yet, okay? And then next week, we'll have the launch of Every Child Arkansas. Jerome's going to be here. It's going to be amazing. Please don't miss it. We do this every week, so you guests that are here, come back and join us. We love having you. And with that, we are adjourned. All right.